Hi guys, Jorge from Sharp 11 Music here, and today I'm very excited to do this review video about the Theo Wanne mouthpieces. I wanted to give this review video a slightly different angle. I will play a bit of them just naked without any music, but then I'll try to figure out how I can best match it to a particular saxophone player that I think sounds in the direction of the mouthpiece. I have around 150 solo transcriptions so far from quite a lot of different alto players, so I'll try to think of a solo that would match the sound and the type of style that mouthpiece gets into. So the mouthpieces I'll be testing in this video are the New York Bros 2, the Earth 2, the GAIA 4, and the Fire. That's all for alto saxophone with a tip opening 8. That's what I'm usually playing. We'll start from the most dark one to the most bright one at the end. And I always kind of work with this internal spectrum of 0 to 100, where 0 represents the most dark sound you'll hear, and 100 represents the brightest sound you'll hear on an alto sax. And 100 is probably, for me, David Sanborn. He has probably the brightest sound and the most, you know, bit aggressive sound. And on the other side for me, at around 0, but not completely 0, is Paul Desmond, who has a very sweet, dark, mellow sound. And then you have everything in between. So I'll give it a rate, which is obviously very subjective to my taste. Let's start with the New York Bros. That's this one. Yes, that's what you could expect from this type of mouthpiece, and it really plays amazingly easy. Actually, it plays super easy. The comfort is high. It is kind of funny how this is a tip opening 8, which is fairly large, but it still in this model feels like it's a 6 or something. Like it's a smaller mouthpiece than a tip opening 8 suggests. I've played Myers before. It's really that, but maybe, as I remember it at least, it plays a bit more easy than the Myers I remember. So this is your typical jazz mouthpiece that just works very fine. It plays really easy. It has a really nice compact sound to it. That's what I like. If I would play in a big band, this would really carry. And if I have to sound match it, then there are two names that really come to mind, which are obviously very Meyer related anyways, and that's Phil Woods and Cannonball. But if I have to choose a solo, I'll go with Cannonball, because it has so much option for dynamics and the dynamic range in phrasing, which is obviously something, you know, Cannonball is out of this world in terms of how he articulates. And I think I have a great transcription for that. So I don't know if that kind of matched the sound, but for me it really felt nice to play that type of solo, this Cannonball approach with all those articulations. It's insane. This mouthpiece comes at $275. Oh yes, and I almost forgot to rate it on my own scale. For me, this is really in the middle. This is a 50, because it's warm. You can sound warm, jazzy on it. It has it's that nice middle pivot point where you can really be flexible with your sound. It still has projection, is warm. It's really a nice 50 for me on scale, and the darkest of the four I'll be testing. So now we go to the second darkest, and that will be the GAIA 4. Okay, so this is quite a bit different than the New York Bros 2. It's really special that it's so thin. You know, you kind of expect this design more from the Bright type of mouthpieces, but still you get a fairly nice wide feeling to it, and it really has this soft subtone in it. It's really versatile. That's actually what I probably thing is the main feature of this mouthpiece. If you really want, you can really add a little bit of that, you know, I'm married to a singer, so twang, what they, you know, that edgy, yeah, the edge on your sound, so that you have that little bit nasal thing, but you know, the thing that projects more, that's really in it. You have that twang, but you also really have the option for the soft sound. So if I put this on my own scale from 0 to 100, this one will be the first mouthpiece I will have to give a range, not a kind of certain set number, but this is probably in between 40 and 60, 65, because it gives you really a lot to work with. It gives also this slightly more edge if you want, while still having this soft jazz sound. And then I think of Phil Woods. He's one of those players that has that, this, you know, this cozy old grandpa sound, but sometimes, you know, also the snappy grandpa was a little bit more to the point. So there is a great blues that I like from him playing on a Quincy Jones album. It's called Walking. I'll try that one. Let's see what you think. So that was a lot of fun, and then we still need to talk about the price. And this one is on the high side. It's $575. But I kind of can see why that is. There are not so many mouthpieces that I know of that give you this kind of versatility. I think that's what you kind of pay for, but it's a great quality mouthpiece. So we are entering the more bright realm of mouthpieces. This is probably more close to my kind of taste of mouthpieces, because I usually with my own band play fusion music, and this has really this sparkle to it. What I think is special about this one is that with a lot of those high baffle mouthpieces, metal mouthpieces to play fusion and funk and smooth jazz and pop, is that it is edgy, you know, but this one has also the bottom range really emphasized, and this I do actually really like a lot about this mouthpiece. And if I have to put it on the scale, you know, on my own scale, then it's a 75, because it's, you know, really a bright mouthpiece, but it has a little bit of that bottom, and it also has definitely that sparkle. And if I have to sound match it with a player, I don't need to think long about this, Eric Marienthal. Eric is such a great player, certainly with the electric band, but I mean with all bands he played in, and he really has this in his style. He's definitely not that bright as a David Sanborn, but he's really on the bright side with a lot of body. So this is the perfect excuse to try this solo, which I was addicted to in my teens, and that's the solo on Blue Miles by Chick Corea. So let's try that and see if it matches. So this mouthpiece, the standard option without the ligature, comes at a $275, which I think is actually not too bad for this type of mouthpiece. Mostly the metal mouthpieces with that kind of material are anyways more expensive, and it's a really great design. It gives you really also headroom, I think, to work with in the bright area of sound. You don't necessarily are pinned to this only bright type of guy there. You really have the sparkle, but also the bottom. You know, for you guys who would like to play smooth jazz, definitely this is something to check out. Mostly with these type of bright mouthpieces with high baffles and stuff, it gets hard to intonate. And this one is one of the very few mouthpieces I ever played that are easier, at least, to intonate on with still this edgy sound. So I don't know how Theo did that, but I mean, definitely a pro to have that with these type of mouthpieces, because it can be hard with the high baffle mouthpieces to get it in tune. That being said, let's go now to the most bright of them all. That's the Fire. Okay, so this is more bright than the Earth, definitely. It plays like, I mean, wow, it's like driving a Ferrari. I've never done that, but I like to think it's like driving a Ferrari, because it goes so fluently. It really comes out, it speaks, it's really bright, it breathes really. And actually, before thinking of a player and the solo transcription, it reminds me of a tune. Nice, really bright, really edgy. If you really do pop and rock stuff, this is a great piece to play that kind of music. It really cuts through. What I like about it is that it's really bright, but not as bright as I probably have thought. I thought it would be something like a Dukov, which would be the 100 on my scale, but this is slightly less aggressive, even in, I think, a bit more controllable. You know, I can even play soft on this. I And that's not something that I've been able to do on those high baffle mouthpieces, playing in a controlled way through the whole range of the horn, because mostly those low notes speak a little bit more difficult on those mouthpieces, and also the high notes, and playing soft is kind of hard. I've played a Dukov, also this is from memory, but I still remember that you could really nail somebody to the wall with it, which was great for some situations, but playing soft was not easy on that. And this dynamic range is really wide, so it gives you still that option. I can also feel the intonation is a little bit harder. Not as hard as I thought it could be on that kind of mouthpiece, but still, it has a bit more headroom. I thought first of David Sanborn when I played it the first couple of minutes, but later I actually have a way better match. It's not a 100 on scale, it's for me around 90, and there comes in Masato Honda. He really has this really controlled, bright sound. You can somewhere hear in him, you know, that probably classical background that keeps him, you know, from being a little bit more holding back than a David Sanborn, and he plays great. So the price for this mouthpiece is the same one as the Earth one, which is part of the Element series. That's also $275 without the ligature, which is, as I said with the Earth one, a very decent price for this type of mouthpiece, I think. So one last general thought about all the Theo Wanne pieces, what they share is that they are mostly not the cheapest on the market, but they are very well made. They are very well crafted, very carefully designed, and you can see it in the finish. It's all being finished to perfection, and that's really, I think, what shines through. They're nice to look at, they're really great, the ligatures really work well, everything is really thought through very well, and it's high quality what you get with Theo Wanne. That's really what I think. Whatever your sound spectrum is that you want to sound like. You know, the reason that I wanted to do this sound matching to certain players is that, you know, you can at least relate to somebody you like or somebody's sound that you really dig. Never try to copy a certain player. I would never advise that, but everybody has this kind of sound in his head he wants to reach, and mostly that is coupled with a certain or a few certain players that they like. So then you can already get in the right area and then pick up a mouthpiece and really work your own ways with it. It's so much fun to then go onto your own journey. But that's at least a starting point, I hope. Guys, I'm really eager to hear if you think I matched this right, or where you kind of have maybe different ideas of different players, or maybe you thought at some places it really didn't match. You can also let me know that. That's all fine, but I had really a lot of fun with this. I'm Jorge Reynes from Sharp 11 Music, and hope to see you next time.